המרצה שתחתום את המושב, אני רוצה שיהיה דיון, היא פרופסור אימנואלה טרוויסן סמי. היא חוקרת, היא יודעת עברית, לכן אני מציגה אותה בעברית. היא חוקרת מדעי היהדות באוניברסיטת קא' פוסקרי בוונציה. היא פרסמה כמה וכמה ספרים, ביניהם ספר על אתיופיה, למרות שהיום היא מרצה על בני הנושאים, אבל על הנושא הזה, בני הנושאים, היא עסקה באיטליה. פרופסור.
תודה, ואני גם רוצה להודות למארגנים את הכנס הזה, כל כך רב משמעות, אני חושבת. אני ארצה באנגלית. Thank you. The question of conversion in the south of Italy, although not involving significant numbers of people, is nonetheless of great social interest. In truth, we are dealing here with hardly more than 100 people scattered throughout Apulia, Sicily, Calabria, the Aeolian Islands and Sardinia. Around 40 of these have converted to Reform Judaism, while others are not recognized by the Italian Beit Din. It is precisely because of this dispersal that generally they do not constitute a minyan. To try to understand better this phenomenon, we need to consider it in the context of the wider migration issue, globalization also, because the leading figures, those who started off the conversion processes and initiated actual chains of converts, had themselves migrated in the past or had contacts with those who had experienced this. Anyhow, although the migration issue is important, it cannot alone explain such a phenomenon, since there are other elements which have acted upon these states of conversion. First of all, there is Israel, which is seen as a pole of both mythical, symbolic and economic attraction in a southern Italy perennially in search of employment and forever a land of emigration. Indeed, not only did the majority of the first Gerim from San Nicandro, if San Nicandro is in Apulia, emigrate to Israel in 1946, but also a few Gerim of recent decades have headed down the same path. Yet Israel exercises another form of influence on the issue of conversions, albeit paradoxically. The obligation to convert, which in Judaism affects anyone who is not a Jew but by maternal filiation, has been made more ambiguous by the political decision to also confer Israelianity on anyone possessing simply a paternal Jewish filiation, and therefore, in a certain sense, on anyone who is only partially Jewish through paternal filiation. Fully conferring this more inclusive type of Israelianity on anyone who is a Jew only through paternal filiation allows also the child of a Jewish father to imagine himself more freely part of the Jewish world. Hence, the greater inclusivity granted by the rules of conferral of Israeli citizenship and therefore Israelianity allows anyone aspiring to conversion to imagine themselves part of a Jewish identity, which on the one hand appears to be more of the Israeli type, while on the other it lies closer to the original biblical identity where filiation was paternal. This biblical Israeli identity would allow potential Gerim to define themselves as Jews out with the rigid prescription of the Halacha laws. However, in Israel, the question of belonging to Judaism has become a political reality in that it entails rights or discrimination in public and social arenas due to one's being or not being recognized as Jew according to Halacha. This has led to the growth of a culture of bureaucratization around being Jew, which was once unknown. According to what I have been told, this allows people to act paradoxically with great greater freedom in welcoming converts and at the same time to reject what is considered a logical bureaucracy. Another factor which has played a significant role in the awakening of interest in Judaism is the symbolic importance of traditionally Jewish places, places of memory bearing witness to ancient Jewish presence in the south of Italy. Many of these places have been discovered in recent decades and continue to be so has happened only recently, and act as bridging areas, conveyors of history and of memory of the past. Neither should we forget that this renewed interest in conversions is taking place in a post-Shoah historical period, following the disappearance of 6 million Jews, of which I was repeatedly reminded in the course of my interviews. The Shoah and the use of Shoah acts on the collective imagination and influences calls for the need to reconstitute the Jewish people in a broader sense. Not least is important that the tools of information technology, such as internet, email, distance learning, and Skype, have in the issue of conversions, since they facilitate contacts, identifications, empathies, the formation of the collective us and proselytism. The history of conversions in southern Italy originated in San Nicandro, and San Nicandro remains a catalyzing moment in the history of conversion in our times. This area, after more than 50 years, not only retains a symbolic and identity form and significance, but plays the part of a potential catalyst able to trigger new processes. The conversion of phenomenon, which began in San Nicandro in the 30s, ended on the Mediterranean at Torre Maletta in 1946 with a collective Tevilah. Conversion was followed by the emigration of most of the converted to Israel between 1948 and 49, while a small core, composed mainly of women and including the founder of the movement, Donato Manduzio, stayed on in San Nicandro. Manduzio died shortly after in 48, but his widow, Emanuela Vocino, and other women remained to bear witness to the conversion. In the contemporary Jewish press reports, that event, already unusual in itself, also because it happened at the height of fascism, becomes even more sacralized because just 4 women remain to keep the tradition. Recalling the 4 mythical Jewish matriarchs, a marker of the sacralization of the history of conversion. It is in any case true that the continuity of the San Nicandro conversion movement was assured by Manduzio's wife, who decided not to live with the others so as to guarantee Saturday prayers. The core of tradition preserved by the San Nicandro women has been recovered in more recent years by Rabbi Shalom Bachbut, who in his role as a member of the Rabbinical Council of Rome found himself facing the issue of San Nicandro, whose worshippers were considered and defined as a Jewish sect. From 2010, Bachbut, in his new role as chief rabbi of Naples and southern Italy, has decided to invest himself in San Nicandro. He found himself confronted with the drive and determination of several women who, to use Bachbut's words, has passed the baton from mother to the daughter and wished again to go down the path of conversion in order to officially join Italian Jewry. We can therefore argue that even in the most recent events, the role played by the women of San Nicandro remains relevant in a place which is highly symbolic in its power to evoke the pioneering history of southern Italy's conversion movements. It was again in San Nicandro that the imaginary line was re-established, going back to the Jews of southern Italy forced into conversion 5 centuries ago. Probably the first time that Manduzio heard talk of Jews being forced to renounce their faith was when in 31 he finally received an answer to the many letters he had written to the chief rabbi of Rome, Angelo Sacerdoti. In this letter, Manduzio asked if there were still Jews in the world. In the chief rabbi's reply, where we read all the incredulity over the fact that there might be converts in the Apulia area, he advances a possible key of interpretation. interpretation. Do you have no tradition that you are descendants of Jewish families forced in the past to convert to Catholicism? This hypothesis was again mooted in the meeting Manduzio had with Pinchas Lapid, Major Spitzer of the Jewish Brigade that had landed in Apulia in November 44. This hypothesis was summed up in a report a conversation between Lapid and Manduzio, in which Manduzio apparently said, "Our ancestors were Spanish Jews around 12 generations ago. They were all Levites, yet they were difficult times given the envy of the Gentiles and internal jealousies, which forced them to hide and then flee. They found refuge here with the Star of David hidden under their shirts and the cross on top of their clothes." Manduzio had responded to the objections raised by the Jewish representatives in Italy by creating a mythical Jewish past and had invented a genealogical and bizarre reconstruction of Marrano descent. They were all Levites. And by doing so, he placed himself in a linear path studded with similar episodes. It is clear that we are witnessing an undeniable historical fact when dealing with the important Jewish presence in southern Italy before the forced conversions. This can be witnessed in the many streets with still bearing the name Giudecca, Meschita, Scolanova. But Jews were forced to convert the Anusim, may secretly have preserved small practices and traditions, which became an engine of great evocative power. However, Manduzio was aware of none of this, as far as we can understand from his diary and from accounts from the times. Hence, it was only subsequently, when he received entreaties from the Jewish circles he encountered, that he built himself a theory with fairly vague outlines of the Jewish-Spanish origin. On the basis we were all Levites. Manduzio realized that descending from Jews forced to convert in the past was a good visiting card to enter the great Jewish family. The claim of the Gerim from Samicandro to be part of the Bnei Anusim, nowadays a fairly common attitude of all converts, in which we might define as imagined identity, has therefore already begun in Samicandro. Yet, beyond the first pioneers such as Donato Manduzio and his wife, and the locality like Samicandro, other leaders and other places have become conduits for conversion. It is a process linked to the mobilization of migrant figures who have had experience outside Italy or have been in contact with someone coming from a migratory experience. And strengthened by the existence of places with a strong mythical and symbolic value. The main actors involved in the recent resumption of the conversion process are indeed all in some way connected to migratory experiences. Shalom Bachbut, the Italian rabbi, who first as a member of the rabbinical council, then a chief rabbi of Naples, now of Venice, actually restarted the process by involving himself with new conversions. Samicandro is of Libyan origin. In particular, his mother, an immigrant from Tripoli, ran a small boarding house in Rome where lodged in 56-57 a young Samicandro convert who was educated in Rome with a view to pursuing a career as a rabbi. So a direct line linked the chief rabbi of Naples to Samicandro through the young girl in Rome and through meetings held by Bachbut when he was in Israel with Gerim from Samicandro. In 2010, Bachbut relaunched his plans by sending a teacher to Samicandro with the intention of once again instituting the practices of conversion. The new conversions of Samicandro people, fewer than 10, were carried out in Ancona from 2011-2012. According to Bachbut's plan, Samicandro would become the community of reference for Apulia, even though other symbolic locations would be mobilized to encourage the conversion of returning Jews. In other words, those Jews who had been forced into baptism 500 years ago and who had kept alive Jewish traditions. Another significant figure within the Apulia conversion movement was Abramo Nicola Zecchillo, originally from Trani, and to whom we owe the initiative of reconverting the Scola Nova Synagogue in Trani. This 13th century synagogue, which had been transformed into St. Mary's Church of Scola Nova in 1541, has today a Magen David on the steeple instead of a cross, and plays an important part in coalescing the Jews of Apulia and Southern Italy in general. Zecchillo, who converted and married in Italy, a Tripoli Jews, and emigrated to Israel, fits into established patterns of migration. After a life spent in Israel, Zecchillo returned to Trani for personal reasons, and here he devoted himself to the certification of Kashrut of Apulia Foodstuffs on behalf of Orthodox Union, a job which is now carried on by other converts. We owe to Zecchillo the re-Judaization of Trani, the launch of public initiatives, and the search for Apulia Nussim, from whom he believed he descended, in order to persuade them to return to Judaism. In Trani, in September 2012, it was decided, on the occasion of a day devoted every year to Jewish culture, to dedicate a whole week to it, called Lech Lecha, and that it would take place in the Scola Nova Synagogue. This annual event has become not only an opportunity to meet the San Nicandro group and other Southern Italian Jews, but also a way of spreading knowledge of Jewish culture and to proselytize. In Sicily, there are two rabbis active in conversion movements, Stefano Di Mauro and Barbara Iello, the first belonging to Orthodox and the latter to Progressive Judaism. Both have a personal migration history, and both believe themselves descended from Anusim. Rabbi Di Mauro, doctor original from Syracuse, who began his conversion path in Italy in the 70s and ended in Jerusalem, makes full claim to belonging to the Bnei Anusim. After conversion, he emigrated to the United States, where he spent most of his life as a doctor and rabbi. He then retraced his steps as he decided to return from Miami to Syracuse when he reached retirement age. Used to the mobility of American life, where making conversions was normal practice in contrast to Italy, Di Mauro continued to make conversions in a Sicilian context, rich in its Jewish past and with people believing to be descendants of Anusim. According to Di Mauro, the conversions achieved often correspond rather to a return home, as he puts it, than to actual conversion, precisely because the people involved were already of Jewish origin. Many traces of its Jewish past still also remain in Sicily. For example, in Syracuse, there are churches which retain the architectural structure of the old synagogues, and there is a large quantity of mikvaot, Jewish tombstones. These synagogues are also places working on bridges to Jewish memory, laden with symbolism and past history. The first group of Di Mauro's converts, about 20, did the Tevilah in one of Ortigia's old Syracuse mikveh, today partially transformed into a hotel lying within the old Jewish quarter. Di Mauro has reintroduced events recalling Syracuse Jewish past, such as the celebration of the Syracuse Purim Katan. From 2011, for example, Purim Katan has been celebrated annually with a public display that sees the participation of the local political and religious dignitaries, and has also become an occasion not only to give visibility to the Jewish presence in Sicily, but also to arouse curiosity in the past of a city and a region which is thought to be still today made up of descendants of the Anusim. In the rabbi's own words, the network of converts today has widened thanks also to the use of the internet, which facilitates research on the possible Jewish origins to one's name. This is also truer in Italy, where, in contrast to the United States, the search for one's origins is not carried out through DNA tests, but through a search for the etymology of one's surname. In the south of Italy, this process is strengthened by the actual possibility of a return home, once the Jewish origin of a surname has been discovered, thanks to rabbis willing and able to back up these efforts. It must be said that today's opportunity to belong to Judaism and therefore to emigrate to Israel represents, in the eyes of future converts, converse, a form of advancement which is not just socio-cultural but also economic in a southern Italy where youth unemployment hovers around 40%. Di Mauro's conversions number around 50 and cover various areas of Sicily, but in last years have not been validated by the Italian Beit Din, formally for reasons of halakha or of a different interpretation of halakha. Also, jealousies growing out of a climate of spite as well as arguments and slander seem to have played their part in this. The second figure dealing with conversion in Sicily is Rabbi Barbara Aiello. Her origins are fairly complex. Her grandmother on her mother's side was born in Sicily and emigrated to Argentina, while her father, originally from Calabria, emigrated to US. Both claimed to belong to the Bnei Anusim. She became a rabbi, according to what she said, in the United States and followed her father in Italy when he wished to return to die in his home in Calabria. Hence, Aiello shares with Rabbi Di Mauro a personal history of migration involving the United States, even though she was born and raised there. Her experience, she claims, is of those brought up in small Sephardic communities made up of Jews of Mediterranean origin who emigrated to the United States after the Shoah, and where it was enough to declare as one belonging to the Bnei Anusim to be considered a Jew, with no need for further rabbinical confirmation. In her 10 years of service in Italy, she practiced 38 conversions, employing the tools of distant learning with those unable to attend the courses. I conclude. So she organized in Serasretta, Shabbaton, Bar Mitzvah, weddings, and so on. It is in the same context that the movement of Shavei Israel is involved in the process of conversions. I conclude. It is in this context that migration, information technology, and the recovery of places rich in Jewish memory in a post-Shoah period play their bridging role, and where Israel is a nearby country offering greater employment opportunities. It is a context where the idea of descending from Jews, who in the distant past were forced to renounce their faith, mobilizes charismatic figures and potential beneficiaries, all intent in turning back the dial of history and beginning a new chapter. Thanks.